But now at 9:30, or very nearly 9:30, John Deathridge sets sail with a trunk full of Wagner recordings, building a library on the Flying Dutchman, not so much a life on the ocean wave as an eternity.
A colleague of Wagner's once said that opening any page of the score of The Flying Dutchman was like running into an icy wind. By that, he meant its orchestral effects, but he also meant its chilling tale of the sailor condemned by the devil to roam the seas until Judgment Day unless he finds the woman who will be faithful to him unto death. The Dutchman falls in love with Senta, a Norwegian girl, but deserts her when he thinks, wrongly, that she's been unfaithful. As he sets sail yet again, she throws herself into the sea to redeem him. But can the bleakness of the Flying Dutchman be conveyed effectively in a recording? The answer, of course, is yes, but not necessarily for a conductor like Herbert von Karajan, whose recording from the early 1980s you've just heard. It's the perfected studio performance without the distraction of bad weather. And it's an ideal opportunity for the great conductor to revel in beautiful sounds created by the wonderful Berlin Philharmonic Orchestra and a hand-picked cast including José van Damme as a tasteful and exquisitely poised Dutchman. No icy winds here. Nor are there in Christoph von Dohnányi's 1994 recording from Decca with the Vienna Philharmonic. Listen, for instance, to Dohnányi enjoying himself hugely with the ending of the overture. The ending of the overture used by Dohnányi was added by Wagner 20 years after he'd composed the opera. It sounds like Tristan and Isolde, and it's meant to. Late in life, Wagner intended to recompose the whole of The Flying Dutchman, but never found the time to do it. That's a pity, perhaps, but doesn't alter the problem that many conductors have been tempted to do it for him by performing the opera too smoothly with inflated orchestral textures that don't have much to do with the work's sparseness and dramatic intensity. This is certainly true of James Levine's version from 1997. Once again, the score's conducted with superb virtuosity. And the cast's promising too, including James Morris as the Dutchman and Deborah Voigt as Senta. But where's its violence and raw emotion, not to mention the icy winds? Everything gets swamped in slow tempi and lush, well-upholstered textures. And even the ship's watchman at the start of the opera sounds as if he's taken too many sleeping pills. Groves as the ship's watchman with the Metropolitan Opera Orchestra conducted by James Levine. Now I'll stop complaining, well almost, and just say that if you like virtuoso conducting and splendid Wagnerian sounds for their own sake, you should buy one of the versions we've just heard. But if you want to get to know the opera well, the older recordings are more rewarding, even if the sound quality isn't always as good. Indeed, the oldest current version is in many ways the liveliest. It's conducted by Fritz Busch in a live broadcast recorded in 1936 with some wonderful singers including Alexander Kipnis and Marjorie Lawrence. And if it weren't for its understandably poor sound, it would be high on my list of recommendations. Here, the point of the opening scene's crystal clear. The watchman begins to fall asleep and the scene wakes up with a bump as the Dutchman's somber ship gradually appears. Hans Fleischer in 1936 with the orchestra of the Teatro Colón in Buenos Aires, conducted by Fritz Busch. The Flying Dutchman can only find redemption by coming ashore every 7 years. But eternal failure in finding the woman who'll be faithful to him unto death has robbed him of hope. His proud bearing when he steps ashore crumbles into despair and a longing for death, the intensity of which only gradually becomes apparent to the audience. For this reason, his opening monologue is one of the most challenging scenes in the entire operatic repertory, requiring huge vocal stamina and great dramatic sensitivity. Few of the Dutchmen on these recordings rise to the challenge, and some even fail spectacularly. But here's one of the best. Was Hermann Uder in a 1955 Bayreuth performance conducted by Josef Keilbert. Uder's tense opening of the Dutchman's monologue sets the tone for an exciting performance that's well matched by Astrid Warnai's centre. Perhaps he reveals the anguish of the Dutchman too soon. The proud bearing of the character isn't much in evidence, with the result that the rest of the opera tends to stay on the level of frenetic melodrama, despite Keilbert's excellent conducting. At first, I thought Bernd Weichel in the most recent recording from Deutsche Grammophon was going to be even better. He starts at a lower level of intensity that's dramatically more appropriate. His entire performance is also helped by a first-rate cast, including Cheryl Studer as Senta and Placido Domingo as Eric, and some very precise conducting from Giuseppe Sinopoli that thankfully resists the carry-on temptation, turning the Dutchman's ship into a luxury cruise liner. But the rest of the monologue's a disaster. Weichel's phrases are oddly clipped, and somehow the sardonic, bitter feeling he obviously wants to bring to the role just serves to make the Dutchman sound cynical and superficial. Bernd Weichel. This is the modern executive sitting morosely at his desk, cursing his bad investments, perhaps. But it doesn't have much to do with the sovereign power of the Flying Dutchman or his barely concealed sorrow and desperation. Not to be recommended, then, despite excellent moments in the rest of the recording. The success of any performance of the opera depends heavily on the Dutchman's opening monologue, and if you're in any doubt, just listen to Thomas Stewart's magnificent interpretation, recorded live in Bayreuth in 1971. Stewart sings like a fallen angel. Everything's there, the sense of terrible justice, the proud stature, and above all, the terrifying call for the end of the world that ends this remarkable scene. Stewart with the Bayreuth Festival Orchestra, conducted by Carl Böhm. Böhm's years of experience with the Dutchman can be heard in every bar of this performance. Apart from a few squeaky planks, Deutsche Grammophon's remastering has also rid the recording of some irritating onstage noises, though without in any way diminishing the tremendous vigour of this live performance and Stewart's powerful interpretation of the title role. It definitely goes on my shortlist. I wish I could say the same about Otto Klemperer's famous studio version recorded in the 1960s with Theo Adam as another memorable Dutchman. Wagner introduces us to Senta with the spinning chorus at the beginning of the second act, where she sits mesmerized by a picture of the Dutchman. Around her there's bustle and gossip, and EMI have even introduced the sound of buzzing spinning wheels to add to the effect. But Klemperer's tempo is almost grotesquely misjudged.
Thank you.
also Klemperer with the BBC Chorus and the New Philharmonia. Klemperer is good on the Wagnerian bits of the Dutchman, and there's no shortage of gale force winds. But lighter passages like these, which the young Wagner borrowed from French opera, elude him entirely. Here, there's no room for heavy weather, as you can tell from this. That was the Bayreuth Festival Chorus, conducted by Waldemar Nelson, in a live performance recorded in 1985. This is the famous Harry Kupfer production, with Simon Estes as the Dutchman and Lisbeth Balzler for centre. Kupfer turned the entire opera into a nightmare fantasy of centres, and its brilliant choreography obviously helped to make this a gripping musical performance. It's another one for my shortlist, and I'll discuss it again in a minute. But first a word about centre. All Wagner said about her was that she has to be a strong Nordic woman who's girlishly naive, yet with no trace of sentimentality. This isn't how she sounds in most modern performances, of course, though I think that's less to do with political correctness than with a shortage of singers willing to negotiate the role's vocal difficulties. Then there's the matter of tempo. Most modern conductors take her ballad at the centre of the opera far too slowly, and certainly not at the tempo Wagner wanted. Perhaps it's not worth taking much notice of this, as interpretations inevitably change with time, but George Scholte does, and the result's decidedly interesting. Janis Martin singing the first verse of Center's ballad with the Chicago Symphony Orchestra, conducted by George Scholte. Despite the freshness of Scholte's conducting, his center, unfortunately, isn't quite right. Janis Martin sounds too tasteful, not wild or irresponsible enough, which can't be said of Anya Celia. She's rightly regarded as one of the most successful centers ever. Her bright, strong lyric voice was well suited to the part when Wieland Wagner discovered her for his Bayreuth production in 1960. She's also helped by the conductor in this recording, Wolfgang Sawallisch, who decided to use the original version of the ballad in a higher key, adding to the bright yet forceful naivety Wagner wanted for the part.
Thank you.
Anja Celia in a live performance from 1960 with the Bayreuth Festival Orchestra conducted by Wolfgang Sawallisch. All the recordings I've mentioned so far are associated with famous names or historic productions. This isn't a guarantee of artistic success, of course, as shown by another recording that's had little critical attention. This is the version conducted by Pinchas Steinberg, issued by Naxos. It's an unpretentious affair, and there are many good things about it, including the difficult part of Eric, Senta's clumsily endearing fiancé, who tries in vain to save her from her fantasies about the Dutchman. Wagner deliberately made the part awkward to sing, though Domingo on the Sinopoli set sings the role too well and too fluently, so charmingly, in fact, that one wonders why on earth Senta would bother to prefer the Dutchman in the first place. But in the Steinberg recording, Peter Seifert sings the role with great accuracy, modestly, yet impassioned, and above all negotiating the technical pitfalls of the part so that they make dramatic sense. Peter Seifert with the Austrian Radio Symphony Orchestra, conducted by Pinchas Steinberg. Steinberg's isn't perhaps a great performance of the Dutchman, but it's well worth listening to for its unforced ensemble work and refreshing ambition to let the opera speak for itself. The same's true of another less well-known version, conducted by Antal Doraty, surely one of the most underestimated conductors of recent times. The cast is perhaps the most evenly matched among the recordings currently available, and Dorati's conducting is outstanding. My only objection, and it's a serious one I'm afraid, is George London as the Dutchman. His voice is simply too regal, too much lost in its own gorgeousness, to give much sense of the Dutchman's haunted vision. Here's the beginning of his duet with Senta, sung here by Leonie Ruzanek. Thank you. George London and Leonie Rizanek with the orchestra of the Royal Opera House Covent Garden, conducted by Antal Dorati. But there's no real intimacy. This is, after all, the Dutchman's first meeting with Senta, for both of them, a frail hope that their relationship will endure. Despite some expert digital remastering from Decca, the studio recording has too many audible tape joins. You might have caught one in that extract. So although I think it's a notable achievement, I can't include it among the very best versions. Now compare Thomas Stewart and Gwyneth Jones in the Böhm recording. Again, Jones's memorable interpretation of Senta hasn't had the critical attention it deserves. Good, she has technical flaws, but she exploits them to reconcile the strength of Senta and her wild unpredictability. Her duet with Stewart's unforgettable Dutchman is one of the high points of all the recordings to date. Thomas Stewart and Gwyneth Jones. In this performance under Carl Böhm, there is real intimacy between the Dutchman and Senta, and Gwyneth Jones gives just the right sense of rapture and vigour to her part. But as always with Wagner, this newly discovered closeness between the lovers can't last long, and neither can the wait for me to tell you who's in the final round. Indeed, it's exactly at this point in the opera that the real test begins. The duet between the Dutchman and Senta is long and vocally taxing, and great energy is needed to carry off the rest of the opera, especially its strenuous ending, in which the Dutchman thinks he's discovered Senta's unfaithfulness. I've whittled down the performances that managed to cope with all of this convincingly to only two, both from Bayreuth. Here's the first, the 1985 recording of the Harry Kupfer production, conducted by Voldemar Nelson, in the exciting scene in the last act when the ghostly crew of the Dutchman's ship is finally coaxed into life.
Thank you.
The Bayreuth Festival Chorus and Orchestra, conducted by Waldemar Nelson. There's no mistaking the howl of the wind here. By insisting on the original version in one act, the producer Harry Kupfer also took the opportunity to reinterpret the opera as a prolonged nightmare with a fatal conclusion. Instead of leaping into the ocean to save the Dutchman at the end, in this production, Senta dies on the street, rejected by her neighbours who slam their windows shut in disgust. There's no redemption and certainly no sentimentality. But not everyone's vocally up to it. Simon Estes as the Dutchman is a tower of strength in the rest of the performance, yet at the very end, the colour of his voice seems to desert him. And Lisbeth Balzlef lacks the exultant tone the music promises. That's part of this astonishing production, of course, but is it convincing? Even in its original version, the ending of Wagner's Flying Dutchman is a happy one. Senta redeems the Dutchman, and they're seen in an embrace in the sky. This is what Wagner was thinking of when he expanded the music of the ending over 20 years after he'd written the opera. And it's this version Carl Böhm uses in the 1971 set from Deutsche Grammophon. Thomas Stewart carries his powerful reading of the Dutchman right up to the finish, so that even his name, Der Fliegende Holländer, sounds like a terrible curse. This gives Gwyneth Jones's Senta all the more reason to reject it with some startling vocal acrobatics. Jones captures Senta's exultant decision to die for the Dutchman much better than Balzlef does on the Nelson set. I'm sorry to put you through the ending of the opera twice in just a few minutes, but I think you'll hear that this time it's quite different. With two great singers at the height of their powers and some exciting conducting from Carl Böhm, it's hard to resist. Di mera alle zone, per fragen selma del note ando strich. Erkennt die Schiff, erschrecken alle frommen, den fliegenden Holländer.
Karl Böhm, live at Bayreuth back in 1971. A Flying Dutchman that stays afloat right to the end, thanks to Thomas Stewart as the sailor redeemed by Gwyneth Jones. John Deathridge can't resist it. It's his first choice, two CDs at mid-price from Deutsche Grammophon.